world. Two escargot, pate, frise, lamb chop, steak frites.
Shouldn't you be doing something?
Two faux filet and a pepper steak. Come on, make the dessert. Chocolate tart, please.
As a cook, tastes and smells are my memories, and now I'm in search of new ones. So I'm leaving New York City and hope to have a few epiphanies around the world, and I'm willing to go to some lengths to do that.
I'm looking for extremes of emotion and experience.
I'll try anything, I'll risk everything, I have nothing to lose. Minneapolis, Minnesota, the towering capital of the grain belt. You might not notice it at first glance, but there's a culinary tug of war going on in these streets. The same conflict seen across America.
It's a struggle between lone independent operators trying to do new things, seduce the public into new ways of eating and looking at food.
Versus the generic uniformity of chains and franchises. Here, in the city that brought you the girl who could turn the world on with her smile, right here in Minneapolis, there beats the very heart of corporate, commodified darkness. The Mall of America.
Behind those concrete blockhouse walls, all your basic human needs, as determined by fiendish marketers, merchandisers, and franchisers, all collected in one place. Bring your plastic, a few shekels, sit, eat, shop, consume, and get bigger, and bigger, and bigger. Either the realization of the American dream, or a candy-colored nightmare. You decide.
So what is a semi-retired brasserie chef doing in the land of the food court? Hey, I've done my homework. I know there's great food in this town, but in order to fully appreciate the peaks, you gotta slog through the valleys. And I gotta admit, there's a personal motive here too. There's also an internal struggle going on. Should I cash in myself? One last big, ugly commercial score?
Welcome to the new town square. This is it. Right in the epicenter of America, and what does that look like? Well, like everywhere else in America. When you go out to eat, when you go out to see your friends, when you go out to shop, more than likely you and certainly your kids are going off to a place like this. This Mall of America. What else do you need?
And so the quest begins, to the food court, and all points in between.
Oh yeah, we gotta see this. My friend Eric at Le Bernardin is getting his knife work's getting a little sloppy. I thought this might be the perfect stocking gift. Stuffer.
That's right. One chop, you have like a French fry sized potato. A couple more chops, you got potato salad or for soups and stews.
Wow, I could fire half my cooks.
It's bulky, it can't be sharpened, and it only does one thing. Hey, I'm sold. But I can't just hoard this culinary miracle all to myself. Who else might want one?
See, one for Emerald. One for Bobby. Oh, who am I forgetting? Martha will be needing one of these for sure.
As much as I want to linger over my gift list, there's just too much to see here. What does the Mall of America have to offer next?
The cereal adventure. It's overwhelming.
As a child, I longed for the wonderful Sugar Jack Rush of brightly colored cereals, expressly forbidden in the Bourdain household. But now, thanks to Mall of America, a childhood dream is finally realized.
Tricks on a stick.
The sugar content in this one tooth decaying treat more than makes up for a decade of fruity cereal goodness I was deprived of as a youth.
I'm going to call my dentist. Ah, nature. It's a beautiful thing, isn't it? In fact, you may not know this, but the first season of Cook Store was filmed entirely in Mall of America. You know the fabulous Mexican barbecue scene? Shot right here. We shoot all of our nature and outdoor footage here in the Central Cook's Tour Studio. And of course, you remember the Cambodian bar scene? And of course, all those underwater scenes. Vietnam, Mexico, St. Martin. Shot here.
Amazing, isn't it? Now, where's that scary food court?
Well, I think now's the time, since I am in Minnesota, for some local, regional, indigenous fare.
Mall of America style, of course. As you could have guessed, the usual suspects are front and center. But I'm looking for something more local in my food court experience.
Wait a minute, Minnesota Picnic. Now this sounds like regional, the real deal, right? This has got to be authentic. What do they eat in Minnesota anyway? Cheese curds and pike on a stick.
That's pike on a stick, all right. Frozen, breaded, deep fried, and a heaping side of cheese curds, also deep fried to golden, crispy perfection. Now, I know what you're thinking. Tony, food that's fried, food that contains cheese, food that's on a stick. Can it get any better than that?
Oh, yeah.
At the Minnesota Picnic, yes. Yes, it can. The deep fried cheesecake, guaranteed to make your cardiologist busier and wealthier.
Deep fried cheesecake. All right. Good to go. Pike on a stick. Cheese curds. Ooh, it's like batter-fried string cheese. And this. This is a tradition I don't know whether it should spread. Oh, Jesus, God, that's awful. It's like, doctor, I'm not getting fat enough. How may I hasten the process? This is perhaps our most dangerous export. It was never nuclear weapons or the CIA. It was this, our fast food culture. It's a terrible sameness, a lowering of expectations, and the ease and convenience of having it all within reach of one's pudgy fingers. Hey, skinny, have a cheese curd.
Have a cheese curd.
Have a cheese curd.
Join us.
Maybe it's the cheese curds. Maybe it's the sugar. Maybe it's just greed. You know, maybe the idea of brand names, franchises, mass market, maybe it's not a bad racket. I should get a piece of the action too, right? I gotta call my agent. I'm feeling a little restless as I struggle to digest that fried cheesecake and ponder the possibility of a lucrative line of Bourdain-branded products.
Now, here he is, Mr. No Fish on Monday himself, Tony Bourdain!
Well, Mr. No Fish on Monday, what did you bring for us today?
Well, Janice, I have something very special. Many in our studio audience and many of our viewers at home have been using what really is an antiquated and frustrating kitchen utensil. And let me show you what that is. Adam?
Oh, Tony, I think you've hit a nerve.
Well, aren't we all tired of pulling, tugging, and destroying our ice cubes? I have the solution. Look at that.
Wow, Tony, those are brilliant.
Janice, this is a futuristic amalgam. It's made of the same material as the stealth bomber. You torque it like this, and the cubes come out perfect every time. And look at those cubes.
Super fantastic, Tony.
And that's not all. Adam, what else do we have?
Chef. We also have the wonderful Anthony Bourdain bobblehead doll.
Wow! Oh, isn't that great?
That really is super, super yummy fantastic.
And to prove that I'm not the blowhard, self-absorbed, narcissistic huckster that I really am, each order will also get a beautiful iron-on embossed dish towel. These are just like the ones we use in professional restaurant situations. So come on, people, start rocking the phones. You know the number.
So, Tony, what are we going to talk about after the break?
Well, Janice, it's a little something for the sour tummies of traveling chefs. I call it Tony B's Liquid Cork.
Don't let this happen to you. Yet. That's my motto. Anyway, before I spiral into a depression about the crushing wave of franchised and name-branded mediocrity, I decide to head for higher ground. Because I don't want my fellow neurotic New Yorkers to look at this and think, yeah, we know there's no good food in the flyover. They'd be wrong.
Right out here in the heartland, there's good food out here and good chefs. And Vincent's in Minneapolis is a perfect example of what I'm talking about.
A lone wolf chef who made his bones at places like Le Bernardin and L'Espinasse before he came out to meat and potatoes country.
And through persistence and adhering to good standards, stuck with his guns, and persevere.
But it wasn't always easy. Moving in a town with a fancy French culinary background and French name is not always an asset.
What was it like when you first opened out here?
You know, I stay conservative at the beginning. You have to. You cook things that people like. I know there is some people who tried to open this kind of restaurant 10 years ago, and they just went down because they weren't ready, the people.
He was smart. He realized he had to gain the trust of the people first before he could start hawking stuff like sweetbreads and pied cochon. But moving the nasty bits, even in New York City, can be tough. You got to ease people into it.
Tell me about this. You have a column, an item on your menu called Something Strange But Good.
Right. My idea was, how can we put them on the menu, kind of tell people you should try it, and it's amazing. We sell a lot. Tripe, you know.
That's right. Right here in the heart of the heartland, he's helped create a market for something most folks still consider the undesirable extras.
So what am I going to be eating today?
I knew you like tripe, so I just put some tripe in. I also make some gnocchi parisienne.
Beautiful.
All right?
That sounds great.
So while Vincent gets to work in the kitchen, I decide to pay a visit to some of his best and brightest.
Setting up for dinner. And in some cases, for tomorrow. I mean, getting ahead, you know? This is a time in between service periods where you got to get your work done. I used to hate service. I always felt like, you know, damn customers were interrupting my work. He's making the pâté. Liver's in there.
Chicken.
Are you in this business for life? Oh, yeah. This is what I miss. I'm sorry. Can you show us your burns? Yeah, see? I feel like such a wuss now. You just got the little one. Cool. Yeah. Got any good ones? Oh, good one. Show us your burns.
Oh,
dude. You've been drinking while you work? Those are good. Inside here. Yeah, I miss those. The sign of honest toil. Even if this man were wearing, like, an Armani suit, he would be immediately recognizable to any and all other cooks and restaurant professionals.
Meanwhile, in more civilized parts of the kitchen, Vincent is putting the finishing touches on some old-school favorites. Tripe Normandy. Tripes cooked in apple cider and bacon and Parisienne-style gnocchi with sautéed porcini mushrooms and a mushroom broth.
Voilà. Voilà.
So, Something Strange But Good is actually also something really good and classic and old school.
Yeah, I mean, this is classic French.
Americans used to eat it.
Yeah.
But, you know, before the 40s.
Why everybody's eating burger?
Fast and easy. Convenient. Yeah. We got rich. We didn't have to learn how to cook all those nasty bits anymore. Go right to what we used to think was the best part and ignore everything else.
Yeah. I think it's changing. I do believe people want to go learn stuff, have fun.
Eat better,
you know. That's what is great. That's what is.
So there's hope for the world.
Yeah. Yeah, there is. My favorite phrase say, this is not too bad for a French guy.
Beyond the food court and the Uber Mall. And while I'm encouraged by yesterday's trip to Vincent's, I can't help but feel that the monolith of mass production is not far behind me, always in the ready, waiting to strike.
American artisanship, it's come to this, and it's getting closer.
Hello.
Heart-cloggingly good. Anthony Bourdain, trampled by spam in central Minneapolis. The struggle continues.
Now, some of you might be thinking that I'm only advocating fancy, wallet-busting restaurants.
Please, don't get me wrong. You don't have to be a 3-star Michelin, 4-star New York Times, however many mobile diamonds or whatever, you know, for me to like you. You could be local, independently owned and operated neighborhood joint.
Take, for example, the Sample Room, where chef and owner Michael McKay is helping to bring good food to Minneapolis. Far from that soul-destroying mall, he gets people in there with immaculately prepared recipes of local favorites like meatloaf, breaded walleye, and sausage. And then he slips them some pâté and goat cheese to boot.
Yes.
Let the revolution begin.
See, the whole thing is the evil spuds behind generic chain food, right? You expect so little, you get exactly what you expected, maybe less. Here, you walk in, you sit down at a bar in a neighborhood joint, and you get, look, it's Escoffier's pâté recipe. It's homemade sausage, homemade mustard. You go in with moderate expectations, and you get so much better.
Mm. Well, that's great.
Actually, I find that people are quite adventurous. It depends on the crowd. You know, we get some of the local neighborhood people who have lived here their whole life will come in. There'll be six of them. They'll order six sausage platters. That's what they want. Then I get some hipsters from uptown coming in here, and they go all over the place.
Are you going to come back here in a year and see a bunch of, like, you know, welders and electricians and elevator operators who just knocked off work, swirling Premier crews in their glass, consulting the wine list?
I'm actually impressed by some of those guys are really coming around that way. You betcha.
Good food should be a blue-collar thing.
Yeah.
The whole French concept of the bistro, the brasserie, French regional country cooking, essentially those are French versions of this. It's not mom or pop, but it may as well be because he spends at least as much time as mom or pop would. It's personal. The decision to make this pâté is a personal decision. It comes straight from the heart.
This is my soul on a piece of paper.
Okay, I'm encouraged. I'm feeling pretty good about things now. The good guys are gaining ground on the battle for personal, unique food. And I know where to find another reliable source of culinary independence.
When you're talking about America, what makes America great, really?
It's a big country.
Well, America's always been a magnet for people from someplace else to come and bring their own traditions and their own supply train to make something good.
So a little ways off the path, I'm able to find a good example, Saigon Cafe.
America's a nation of immigrants. And recent immigrants are often the ones who hang on to their culture most fiercely. When you're not only struggling to make good food, but struggling to hang on to your whole cultural identity and your sense of yourself, chances are you're making good food. You're not confused. You know, you know that they're making, you know, teriyaki burger. Proud cooks are good cooks.
Okay, enough social observation. Let's eat.
Spring roll gotta have.
Saigon special, a fresh eye round, flank, brisket, tripe, tendon, and beef meatball.
Yeah, baby, that's gotta be good, right?
Of course, in Vietnam, you drink tea while you're waiting for your coffee.
Oh, yeah. Slow-brewed Vietnamese coffee over condensed milk.
Now, I happen to think this is one of the most beautiful sights you can encounter. There's this part where it all drips, and then there's the part where it all runs over the ice. Oh, yeah. You're making chocolate milk. You know that chocolate syrup that accumulates at the bottom, and there's a thick, syrupy layer? It's kind of like that, only different.
Next up, spring roll.
Oh, look at that. Come on.
So pretty. So pretty.
Fresh mint, fresh rice, fresh roast pork, shrimp, then rice paper, little fish sauce. So good.
And here's that Saigon special, a heaping bowl of pho. This is real Vietnamese, not homogenized, standardized like in a food court.
That's good. It's made in seconds. Fast food can be good food.
And the folks at Saigon Cafe are proving that every day, serving great food that preserves their culture while it expands American culture.
30 years from now, this will be as American as spaghetti and meatballs, pizza, chopped liver, pastrami, sandwich.
Culturally conscious, locally owned, this place beats Bob's Big Boy or DGI McFunster's any day of the week. Okay, I'm in a new town, and I want to end the day the right way, at a good burger joint.
So anyway, here we are at Joe's Garage, named, I believe, after a Frank Zappa record, so how bad can it be?
All right, the place is nothing fancy. So what? It's laid back with no apparent dress code, a little funky, and I have room to spread some more special observations.
When in doubt, in moments of extremis, when in America, an independent operator who serves a good burger is always a good thing.
But Tony, you say, what about all the grease, blood, and delicious animal fat?
There's nothing wrong with a burger, okay? As long as it's not something you eat every day. I mean, then it becomes kind of sad and grim. But a hamburger, a properly cooked hamburger, is a beautiful thing. What's not to like? A big, juicy, bleeding hunk of ground beef, bread, and garnishes. Nothing to be ashamed of there. You'd be ashamed when you eat a burger that they have to spray with beef flavor to make it taste like a burger. It's a betrayal of the promise of America. And the promise of America is a damn good hamburger available everywhere by somebody whose name you know, like Mom or Pop or Joe. But our whole idea of the hamburger, like our whole idea of America, has become twisted. We've lost touch with the greatness of our own land, our own indigenous national dish. Unless you're talking about the White Castle, by the way, which is, for whatever disturbing reason, strangely and frighteningly delicious.
Oh, cat's out of the bag.
I'm not a snob. It's not all foie gras and microgreens for me. I'm a man of the people. I know how to live. Hey, give me a damn beer, an ashtray, and a freaking burger, and I'm happy.
Is there anything else I can get for you?
No, it's all good. Looks fine to me. Thanks. No onion tonight. Just beef, bread, and ketchup.
This is wide mouth.
Oh, Jesus. Not bad looking fries either. Not the usual generica.
Brutal fight to get people into the really good restaurants. That doesn't mean that love isn't involved.
What you're trying to do is genuinely bring people over in a gentle and seductive way, even a slightly sneaky way, but an affectionate way, to your side of the argument. Now, a good example of that, of course, is Aquavit.
Aquavit was already a big success as a creative, high-end restaurant in New York that served cutting-edge Scandinavian fusion cuisine. Feeling strong, they decided to branch out into the Midwest.
When they came out here the first time, they thought, hey, it's going to be easy. Scandinavian heartland, right? Scandinavian food. Okay, a little cutting edge. It's big in New York. It's got to be big in Minneapolis, right? Wrong. They had a very tough time here initially. They came out with those big plates with tiny little bits of rare seared tuna and salmon and a lot of that raw and cured fish. A lot of people freaked. They had to kind of step back and retrench, move back to Swedish meatballs. Very good Swedish meatballs, mind you, but still, Swedish meatballs.
And so, with a lot of perseverance and a slow expansion of their menu, Aquavit has been able to establish itself as a major force in Minneapolis.
It makes things better for everybody. And this restaurant has made things better for a lot of the restaurants around it.
I think it was a person-by-person approach. Once everybody came in and sat down and we explained the dishes in detail, once they're in front of the guests, that brought the questions to a minimum. People understood what was in front of them.
And Chef Roger Johnson gives me a sampling of the Aquavit menu, both the conventional and the unexpected.
We have a lot of traditional things. Smoked salmon, cured salmon.
Beef brisket and horseradish, herb and garlic herring, fried Baltic herring. But I'm going to need something to wash all this stuff down.
I should drink Aquavit
with this.
Cancel the night shoot.
So what do you drink at Aquavit? Well, Aquavit, which is potato-based vodka.
We do everything from raspberry to passion fruit to cloudberry to gooseberry. Horseradish is one of the favorites.
They make vats of this stuff. They make martinis with it. They've got Aquavit that's loaded into old sherry casks and shipped out into the ocean for 4 months. Why? Enough of this stuff, you'll make those kind of choices.
A bit more full body.
Oh, that is good.
I want to be thorough, so I even try the girly flavored Aquavit.
Not enough alcohol in your champagne? You have a remedy.
That's right. Aquavit, champagne, and ginger.
Tony, I think that's a sipper.
Suffice to say, Aquavit, the restaurant, and the drink are a good way to end this trip. So there's been some good places in Minneapolis, but the corporate vultures are there too. And who knows where it will end. After the struggle for America's soul, who will be left standing? What will the future look like?